In 1909, a former wool warehouse for the carpet factory was converted into the Palace Theatre by Mr. T.C. Rawes. He also owned the Victoria Theatre Stanley. The opening night on August the 9th had the usual variety fair and up-to-date living pictures to be shown on the aptly named Cathedoscope. The fireproof projection booth was in the centre of the gallery, probably like this contemporary postcard illustration. Two one-reel films, Nick Carter Detective and William's Suicide, were shown. The Palace was allowed to have a notice board in the marketplace. The Assembly Rooms continued to be the venue for the travelling showmen. Randall Williams managed to fit his big cinematograph show into the Durham marketplace each new year. The Assembly Hall Coxo was the first local venue for permanent variety and film shows. Mrs. Coleridge, the proprietor's wife, accompanied the films on the piano.
In August, the Assembly Rooms changed to full-time film shows with the occasional break for live theatre and variety. Unfortunately, despite the acclamation that Wells' well-known pictures would be at the Assembly Rooms, the origin of the showman has not been discovered. His first programme was full of recent releases, including the British drama Lieutenant Rose RN, that gave rise to a whole series of adventure films. The venture at the Assembly Rooms proved to be so popular that Mr. Rushworth himself took over from Mr. Wells in September 1910. In June, there were packed houses for the showing of the films of George V's coronation. In August 1911, the Palace leased its building for 1 year to a former fairground showman, John Cotterill, for the showing of films interspersed with variety acts. In 1912, there were applications for the building of two picture halls in North Road. Only one of these was actually built, and on the 5th of May 1913, the Globe, owned by local builder Jasper Kell, was opened by Durham's mayor and mayoress. The Globe was 70 feet long and 25 feet wide, with a small gallery at the rear. It had accommodation for 500 patrons. It was approached via a covered corridor. The Assembly Rooms, now conscious of the Globe's rivalry, called itself the picture pastime to perfection. It also resorted to an older crowd puller by engaging a film cameraman to take local views. The installation of the Duke of Northumberland as Chancellor at the University was its main feature. Films were getting longer. The Globe was showing the 4,000-foot French mystery Fantomas in June 1913. At the same time, the Palace had a special week-long engagement of the Italian film of Quo Vadis. The Palace clearly only had one projector, for the report says that the film had six scenes with a very short interval between them. There are vivid scenes of the burning of Rome, the report went on, and the sacrifice of the Christians. Kinemacolour appeared in Durham in August 1913. Mr. Raws at the Palace seemed to have the edge on the other houses when it came to innovative scoops. Kinemacolour was a two-colour process using red and green disc for its camera and its projector. By this means, two black and white images with different contrasts were produced. When these were projected at double the normal speed, an illusion of colour was produced on the screen. One of the most famous Kinemacolour films of the Delhi Durbar was seen as part of the programme. In October, the Assembly Room showed the 11,000-foot Pathé version of Les Miserables on a once-nightly basis. The Globe was the first Durham cinema to show a form of talking pictures. The vivaphone was the invention of the Cecil Hepworth studio. The artists mimed to a record. This enabled them to move around and not to be near the microphone. Amplification was a problem, and the system was only suitable for small theatres. By 1914, nearly all the local pit villages and communities had at least one cinema. Some were simply conversions of the miners' hall. In April 1917, the Palace reopened with a showing of D.W. Griffith's epic film, The Birth of a Nation. The theatre had been closed since October 1916, when Frederick Raws was called up. Mr. Raws, Sr. had said that he was too infirm to continue on his own. He had leased the theatre to Messrs. Bolam and Pickering for both variety acts and films. It remained a live theatre until 1921. But even after this, it had occasional forays into variety. When the Crescent Cinema Gilesgate Moor opened in March 1928, it hardly ranked a comment in the Durham Advertiser. This tiny 320-seater cinema was owned by Mr. George Lamb. Since it came under the County Police Division, it was able to obtain a Sunday opening licence. When the Palladium opened its doors in March 1929, it too was granted a 7-day licence, to the consternation of the local clergy, who claimed not to have been given enough notice of the application. The Palladium was altogether a grand development for the city, since it was designed as a cinema and as a theatre. The special report said that Durham was excellently served by its picture halls, which had brought real happiness and pleasure to the lives of its citizens. Sloping ground was a distinct advantage for the positioning of the stalls and the balcony. The stage gave enough room for a 20-foot by 17.5-foot screen. Although sound films were fast taking over in Newcastle, the opening film at the Palladium was Rex Ingram's silent costume drama, The Garden of Allah. The first Sunday film in Durham was, significantly, Cecil B. DeMille's King of Kings. Sections of it were in colour. Thank you. Some cinemas claimed their right to show Sunday films. The Globe had a reissue of Buster Keaton's Steamboat Junior, and the Palace showed a 1928 comedy, Love and Learn, with Esther Ralston. The Assembly Rooms never applied for a Sunday licence, and the seven-day licence itself was short-lived, for in 1932, the magistrates refused again. The Belle of Brittany was staged at the Palladium in April by the Durham Excelsior Amateur Operatic Company, and the Palladium Orchestra provided the musical accompaniment.
In January 1929, the Bishop Auckland Hippodrome was the first cinema in the area to show talkie films. Mr. Drummond, the owner, was also a proprietor of the Palladium Durham.
The films had been made by British Acoustic Films in a system patented in 1924. At that time, no one wanted it. Now, it was in demand. Close Harmony was the first sound film of the talkie era to be shown in a city cinema. The Palace had closed for 1 week in November 1929 for the installation of the equipment in the newly completed exterior projection room. The film's one enduring feature was the inclusion of the musical number 12th Street Rag. The Palladium equipped itself with a Western Electric sound system for showing its first talkie, the Broadway Melody.
That's the Broadway Melody!
In March, the last advertisement appeared for the Assembly Rooms. It closed as a cinema and was sold to the university. In April 1930, John Peacock of Newcastle became the proprietor of the Globe. Sound conversion followed immediately without any special publicity. In January 1934, a fire damaged a section of the Palladium Auditorium. Prompt action by the Bobby on the Beat alerted the fire engines and disaster was averted. The Palladium managed to reopen in March, just a week before Durham's newest cinema opened.
The Regal was built adjacent to the old Miners' Hall by Joseph Dobson of Newcastle.
There had been plans to convert the building since 1917, and a postcard of the early 20s shows a sign saying New Picture Hall Site. Waterproofing the foundation had delayed the construction for a long time. Pumps are still required to keep the water level down. This postcard shows the cinema under construction in 1933. The opening was a grand affair, with the mayor and mayoress in attendance.
I want you to join in and sing the choruses with me. See if we can't make the rafters ring. They've had the roof specially tested.
The opening film was only a 66-minute supporting comedy with Slim Somerville and Zazu Pitts, obviously chosen to allow time for the ceremonies and speeches. It was replaced on the second day by Gold Diggers of 1933.
We're in the money, we're in the money. We've got a lot of what it takes to get along.
Mr. Dobson didn't live long enough to see the success of his enterprise. He died on August 17, 1934. Many said that the tribulations of building the theatre had taxed his health. The 30s was a boom time for cinema building, and in August 1938, the Majestic was opened on Sherburn Road to cater for the new estate. It was built by the owners of the Palladium in a grand design. It had seating for 906 patrons.
A great increase in attendances, and even in the post-war austerity, the cinema was very popular. The Regal was bought by the Osoldo Circuit in 1946. The Palace was leased from the Rawes family in 1948 by the same company. During that year, Mrs. Rawes died. She'd been the mainstay of the theatre for many years. With the arrival of television, gimmicks were needed to hold cinema audiences, and a number of 3D films were shown in Durham.
See the world in lights and improve your mind. See the Chamber of Horrors and scare yourself out of a year's growth.
Columbia's black and white Man in the Dark followed.
I'm sure you'd all like to know something about the new entertainment miracle, third dimension, what it is, what it does. Well, the best way I can describe it to you is to tell you that it makes the screen absolutely real and alive.
The Globe attempted to woo the local film fans with foreign and classic films, with very little success. CinemaScope conversion at the Palladium took place in May 1953.
Robe, from one of the greatest novels of all time. The most inspired story of love and devotion.
The Osoldo converted in February 1954 with the epic film The Egyptian.
Starring Jean Simmons as Merit, the tavern girl. Victor Mature as Horemheb, the general. Jean Tierney as Bakataman, the princess royal. Michael Wilding as Akhenaten, the pharaoh. Bella Darby as Nefer, the Babylonian temptress. Peter Ustinov as Kaptah, the thief. And Edmund Purdom as Sinue, the Egyptian.
Although the Globe put in new projectors and a new sound system in 1954, it never converted to CinemaScope. In March 1955, no objection to Sunday opening was received by the licensing magistrates in the city. Television was now so firmly established in homes that opposition to Sunday entertainment was clearly at odds with reality. By 1957, cinema closures in the country had reached record proportions. The Globe had attempted once again to attract audiences with foreign classics and ex-certificate films, but in July 1957 it announced its closure. The Rex followed in January. It had always struggled to maintain an audience, and even the faithful few patrons could not halt the inevitable closure. It is not all gloom and doom, for in Sacriston in September 1957, the new cinema had opened. In December 1961, the Majestic put on its last show and converted to bingo. The palace was due for demolition as part of the new road scheme and closed on February 1, 1964. In 1967, the Palladium underwent an expensive refit. Its CinemaScope screen was increased in size, and its whole sound system was upgraded.
The most powerful motion picture entertainment of all time. The Bible. In the beginning. The wonder of creation. The terror of Adam and Eve after the first sin.
But despite all this, audiences continued to diminish, and as colour television arrived on the scene, the Palladium 2 announced its closure. For a time, the Asoldo, now the Classic, did better business, and with films like Jaws to draw audiences, there was something of a cinema revival. A two-screen conversion of the Classic took place in May 1979, and the Mayor, Jim Latimer, performed the opening ceremony. There were 600 seats in Cinema 1, the old stalls, and 400 seats in Cinema 2, constructed from the original balcony. The Classic cinema circuit was eventually taken over by the Canon circuit. In line with their planned asset stripping, they disposed of 16 of their 150 cinemas. In July 1990, the Durham Canon was one of the casualties, and the city was left with no cinema at all. On July the 18th, 1991, the Robin Cinema reopened the building after spending £250,000 on refurbishments. Cinderella, you're as lovely as your name. Cinderella, you're a sunset in a frame. Initially, it ran as a two-screen venue, with a further £25,000 from a consortium of Northern Arts, Durham City Council and the British Film Institute, third and fourth screens were added. Screen 4 was intended to be reserved as an art screen for the showing of non-mainstream films. For the last 10 years, enterprising programming had maintained a faithful clientele amongst the Durham citizens. Plans for a leisure complex in Walkergate have variously included 10, 8 and 6 cinema screens, but so far no licensee for its operation has been found. The Durham cinema story may once again end with a blank screen.